Welcome to our Good Friday meditation. This is for St. Martin's Dalry, but welcome if you are coming in from elsewhere. The PowerPoint presentation or the presentation that you are about to watch runs by itself. There will be readings followed by quiet meditative music or music that fits the topic at the time. You are free, please, to lower the volume. You can do it in silence if you wish, or you can listen to what the readings, and you can listen to the music. At the end, you may also want to just spend some moments in quiet meditation, in silence. It runs for about 45 minutes in total. When the hour came, he took his place at table and the apostles with him. And he said to them, "How I have longed to eat this Passover with you before my death. For I tell you, never again shall I eat it until the time when it finds its fulfillment in the kingdom of God." Then he took a cup, and after giving thanks, he said, "Take this and share it among yourselves. For I tell you, from this moment I shall not drink the fruit of the vine until the time when the kingdom of God comes." Then he took bread, and after giving thanks, he broke it and gave it to them with the words, "This is my body." "Even now my betrayer is here, his hand with mine on the table. For the Son of Man is going his appointed way. But alas for that man by whom he is betrayed." At that they began to ask among themselves which of them it could possibly be who was to do this. Then he went out and made his way, as usual, to the Mount of Olives, accompanied by the disciples. When he reached the place, he said to them, "Pray that you may be spared the test." He himself withdrew from them about a stone's throw, knelt down and began to pray. "Father, if it be your will, take this cup from me, yet not my will but yours be done." And now there appeared to him an angel from heaven bringing him strength, and in anguish of spirit he prayed the more urgently, and his sweat was like drops of blood falling to the ground. When he rose from prayer and came to the disciples, he found them asleep, worn out by grief. "Why are you sleeping?" he said. "Rise and pray that you may be spared the test."
Watch with me.
While he was still speaking, a crowd appeared with a man called Judas, one of the 12, at their head. He came up to Jesus to kiss him, but Jesus said, "Judas, would you betray the Son of Man with a kiss?" When his followers saw what was coming, they said, "Lord, shall we use our swords?" And one of them struck at the high priest's servant, cutting off his right ear. But Jesus answered, "Stop! No more of that." Then he touched the man's ear and healed him. Turning to the chief priests and the temple guards and the elders who had come to seize him, he said, "Do you take me for a robber that you have come out with swords and cudgels? Day after day I have been with you in the temple, and you did not raise a hand against me. But this is your hour, when darkness reigns." Then they arrested him and led him away.
Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. On your creation, on the word you made, on every creature,
They brought him to the high priest's house, and Peter followed at a distance. They lit a fire in the middle of the courtyard and sat round it, and Peter sat among them. A serving maid who saw him sitting in the firelight stared at him and said, "This man was with him too." But he denied it. "I do not know him," he said. A little later a man noticed him and said, "You are also one of them." But Peter said to him, "No, I'm not." About an hour passed, and someone else spoke more strongly still. "Of course he was with him. He must have been. He's a Galilean." But Peter said, "I do not know what you're talking about." At that moment, while he was still speaking, a cock crowed, and the Lord turned and looked at Peter. Peter remembered the Lord's words, "Tonight before the cock crows, you will disown me three times." And he went outside and wept bitterly. The men who were guarding Jesus mocked him. They beat him. They blindfolded him. They kept asking him, "If you are a prophet, tell us who hit you." And so they went on heaping insults upon him. As soon as it was day, the elders of the people, chief priests and scribes, assembled, and he was brought before their council. "Tell us," they said, "are you the Messiah?" "If I tell you," he replied, "you will not believe me, and if I ask questions, you will not answer. But from now on, the Son of Man will be seated at the right hand of Almighty God." "You are the Son of God, then?" they all said, and he replied, "It is you who say I am." At that they said, "What further evidence do we need? We've heard this ourselves from his own lips." With that, the whole assembly rose and brought him before Pilate. They opened the case against him by saying, "We found this man subverting our nation, opposing the payment of taxes to Caesar, and claiming to be Messiah, a king." Pilate asked him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" He replied, "The words are yours." Pilate then said to the chief priests and the crowd, "I find no case for this man to answer." But they insisted, "His teaching is causing unrest among the people all over Judea. It started from Galilee and now has spread here." Pilate now summoned the chief priests, councillors and people and said to them, "You brought this man before me on a charge of subversion, but as you see, I myself have examined him in your presence and found nothing in him to support your charges. Clearly he has done nothing to deserve death. I therefore propose to flog him and let him go." But there was a general outcry, "Away with him! Set Barabbas free!" Now Barabbas had been put in prison for his part in a rising in the city and for murder. Pilate addressed them again in his desire to release Jesus, but they shouted back, "Crucify him! Crucify him!" For the third time he spoke to them, "Why, what wrong has he done? I have not found him guilty of any capital offence. I will therefore flog him and let him go." But they persisted with their demand, shouting that Jesus should be crucified. Their shouts prevailed, and Pilate decided that they should have their way. He released the man they asked for, the man who had been put in prison for insurrection and murder, and gave Jesus over to their will.
Oh,
As they led him away to execution, they took hold of a man called Simon from Cyrene, on his way in from the country. Putting the cross on his back, they made him carry it behind Jesus. Great numbers of people followed, among them many women who mourned and lamented over him. Jesus turned to them and said, "Daughters of Jerusalem, do not weep for me. Weep for yourselves and your children, for the days are surely coming when people will say, 'Happy are the barren, the wombs that never bore a child, the breasts that never fed one.' And then they will begin to say to the mountains, 'Fall on us,' and to the hills, 'Cover us.' For if these things were done when the wood is green, what will happen when it's dry?" There were two others with him, criminals who were being led out to execution, and when they reached the place called the Skull, they crucified him there and the criminals with him, one on his right and the other on his left.
Thank you.
Jesus said, "Father, forgive them. They do not know what they are doing." They shared out his clothes by casting lots. The people stood looking on, and their rulers jeered at him. He saved others. Now let him save himself, if this is God's Messiah, his chosen. The soldiers joined in the mockery and came forward offering him sour wine. "If you are the king of the Jews," they said, "save yourself." There was an inscription above his head which read, "This is the king of the Jews." One of the criminals hanging there taunted him, "Are you not the Messiah? Save yourself and us." But the other rebuked him, "Have you no fear of God? You are under the same sentence as he is. In our case it is plain justice. We are paying the price for our misdeeds, but this man has done nothing wrong." And he said, "Jesus, remember me when you come to your throne." Jesus answered, "Truly I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise." By now it was about midday, and darkness fell over the whole land, which lasted until 3 in the afternoon. The sun's light failed, and the curtain of the temple was torn in two. Then Jesus uttered a loud cry and said, "Father, into your hands I commit my spirit." And with these words he died. When the centurion saw what had happened, he gave praise to God. "Beyond all doubt," he said, "this man was innocent." The crowd who had assembled for the spectacle, when they saw what had happened, went home, beating their breasts. The crowd who had assembled for the spectacle, when they saw what had happened, went home, beating their breasts. His friends had all been standing at a distance. The women who had accompanied him from Galilee stood with them and watched it all. Now there was a man called Joseph, a member of the council, a good and upright man, who had dissented from their policy and the action they had taken. He came from the Judean town of Arimathea, and he was one who looked forward to the kingdom of God. This man now approached Pilate and asked him for the body of Jesus. Taking it down from the cross, he wrapped it in a linen sheet and laid it in a tomb cut out of the rock, in which no one had been laid before. It was the day of preparation, and the Sabbath was about to begin. The women who had accompanied Jesus from Galilee followed. They took note of the tomb and saw his body laid in it. Then they went home and prepared spices and perfumes, and on the Sabbath they rested in obedience to the commandment.
Jesus.